Tervetuloa, Velkommen. Welcome today for our special edition of Visiting Glacier Bay National Park. I'm really excited you guys are here because I made this specifically for you guys. But before we get started, have you guys visited a national park? And of course, this is a map of the US, but you guys are all in Finland or Norway right now. So what national parks have you guys been to in your own countries? And you can either type in your response or you can unmute yourself and share.
I've been to a few in the US.
Okay. Where have you been?
To several in California and in Hawaii. And there's one in Maine also, right?
Yeah, Acadia.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great. Thanks for sharing.
I'm from Utah, so I've been to most Utah national parks before I came to Finland. So I've been to a lot, especially to Zion's down south in Utah. In Finland, I've been at, I'm trying to remember now. There is one in Finland I've been to, but I can't remember the name.
That's where I know.
Yeah, Repovesi. Yeah.
Yeah. I know at Luke we went to Repovesi backpacking, so that was my like first time ever backpacking, so that was a very special trip that I always remember in Finland, so yeah. Anyone else have any places they want to share? You don't have to, it's okay. So before I came here to Glacier Bay, I was working at a little national historic site called Fort Union Training Post on the North Dakota-Montana border. And this summer, I'm going to be working at Sleeping Bear Dunes National Lakeshore, which is right here in Michigan. But this is where we are today. We're up here in Glacier Bay, and we're down on the Alaska Panhandle, and we're right up against the ocean. So just a little bit about Glacier Bay. For Americans out there, we're roughly the size of Connecticut, but we're over 8,000 kilometers, so pretty big. We first became a national monument in 1925, and then a national park and preserve in 1980. And we're also a UNESCO Biosphere Reserve and a World Heritage Site. And UNESCO just stands for the United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization. So we have some international connections. And for those of you in Norway, you may have been to these places. And these are also part of our sister park, which is Western Norwegian Fjords. So if you're ever in Norway, that's some of the connections we have here to Glacier Bay. But this is what the Earth looked like more than 11,000 years ago during the Pleistocene. And so you can tell Norway and Finland were all covered in ice, and we were here in Alaska too. So this landscape has really been shaped by the glaciers. And we're going to talk a little bit about how glaciers can change the landscape. So here in Glacier Bay, it looked quite different from today. So 1500 years ago, this orangey area was all outwash. And this is the glacier back here in this kind of whitish, bluish color. And so this outwash was all different sediment that had been pushed forth by ancient glaciers. So you used to be able to walk across this whole area. Right now it's all underwater, so you can't. But right here, this was the Klingit village, this red star. And so the Klingit, they used to live here. Like I was saying, it looked much different from today. So it was once a grassy valley and there was a river running through it. And so the Klingit would hunt here, they would forage for berries, and they would also fish a lot. But then you see these glaciers in the background here. During the late 1600s, there was this global phenomenon called the Little Ice Age. And so that's when the planet started to cool. And these glaciers in the background, they surged forward and they pushed the Klingit out. And so the Klingit went from here in Glacier Bay down to Huna, and their ancestors are still in Huna. But this is their ancestral homeland, so it's a very sacred place. And so here on site, we have a tribal house, and this is kind of what it looks like inside. And they'll still come today and hold different celebrations inside. And their artwork, dance, and stories also reflects their connection to this area. So that glacier that pushed the Klingit people out was called the Grand Pacific. but it's changed a lot. So since the 1750, the Grand Pacific Glacier has retreated like miles or kilometers. And so this is a question for you guys. So all the kilometers are in the parentheses here. So you got to use your fingers to show me how far you think it's retreated. So 13 kilometers, hold up one finger. For 48 kilometers, two fingers. For 105, hold up three. For 232. Okay, I see lots of fives and a four. Fives and fours. All right, so those are good guesses. Hasn't quite gone that far yet, but it is still moving back. So one day, so it's gone back 105 kilometers, so pretty far. And as it has gone back, it has actually separated into three separate glaciers. So the Reed, John Hopkins, and today this is what we consider the Grand Pacific. And so you can see the ice is actually back here and it's more on the Canadian side of the border. So not a whole lot left in this side of the park. And so when the glaciers do retreat, we're left with these clear rocky areas. And it's also a chance to study primary plant succession. And so that's what happens when the ice goes away and plants start to come back. And so first we'll end up with our moss and our lichens, and then we'll start getting grasses and vascular plants, which are like ferns and some flowers. And then finally we'll get bushes. And after about 200 years is when we start getting the forests. But again, that's called primary plant succession. And that's one of the reasons why this land was actually set aside to be protected, was because it's one of the few places where this has been able to be studied. And another cool thing that we find once the glaciers recede are these interstadial stumps. And so these stumps represent the remains of ancient forests. And researchers here have actually found stumps that were more than 400 years old when they were covered by glaciers more than 7,000 years ago. So really some ancient forests. But with a name like Glacier Bay, you know we got a lot of glaciers here. So how many do you think we have? 220, 811, 1,045, or 2,006? And you can use your fingers to show me. I see twos and threes and fours, okay, all across the spectrum. Well, those of you guys who put up three fingers, you're right. So we have 1,045 here. And we have two main types of glaciers. But I first want to tell you how glaciers are made. Does anyone know how they're made? Any guesses? You can unmute yourself if you want. Otherwise, I will show you. And I got some handy dandy marshmallows here that's gonna act as our snow. So high up in the mountains, we got lots of snowflakes falling down, right? And so these snowflakes, they're gonna be falling and they're gonna keep hitting each other and combining. And so as they do, they're gonna compress each other. And eventually we end up with these big blocks of ice or marshmallows in this case. But you might notice there's still all these little air pockets in them. And that's how the glaciers are too. They also have these air pockets. This is kind of a better picture of what that looks like. We got all that snow falling down and compressing into ice. And so once that ice gets really heavy, which you can imagine when there's billions of snowflakes falling, it's gonna become pressurized. So the bottom is actually gonna melt a little bit and gravity is gonna start taking it downhill. So that's why they're also called rivers of ice. And so high up in the mountains, that's where these glaciers start. And this is one of the most common types of glaciers we have here. And this is the Valley Glacier. So this is where the ice starts and it starts working its way down, but it gets contained within these steep valley walls here. And then the other kind of glacier we have is going to be our Tidewater Glacier. So again, we get that ice that starts up high in the mountains and works its way down, but this time it's going to end here in the ocean. So that's what makes it the Tidewater Glacier. And when it does, it breaks off like this. Does anyone know what this process is called? Any guesses? No? That's okay. Ailey, you don't know this? Come on. I'm just kidding. Yeah, this is going to be called calving. So that's what happens when the ice breaks off. And this is a video of what it looks like. So you can imagine if you were out in your kayak, you probably don't want to get very close to these glaciers because it makes a pretty big wave when they fall off. But it also is really important. So why do you think that the glaciers calving off is important? Any guesses? I mean, we can see some wildlife out here. Does anyone have any guesses?
I guess you can make nests.
It oxygenates. For the water.
Oxygen for the water, okay.
Anything you can make nests on them.
Yeah. Yeah. Good place to rest. Yeah, that's all good guesses. And so you can tell, does anyone know what these animals are first? Yeah,
seals?
Are out. They not seals?
Yeah, no, these are going to be harbor seals. And so you can tell these seals like being on the icebergs. And that's because these harbor seals, they have these really short front flippers. So they can't get out onto the land. Instead, they can only get out onto the icebergs. So it's a good place for them to be able to warm up, rest, and also stay safe. So we also have these animals here. You can go ahead and shout it out if you know what they are.
Walrus.
Walrus, okay. Close. Close, close. Any other guesses?
That's not a tiger seal, is it?
A tiger seal? No, it's not a tiger seal. I don't know that we have any of those here, but that's another really good guess. Yeah, so these are going to be our stellar sea lions. So they're kind of like walruses and like other kinds of seals. We also sometimes have the California sea lions here, but this is kind of the northernmost range, so we don't see as many of those. But the main difference is that these guys are going to be a lot bigger. And you can tell this is a male right here, and they weigh about just over a ton. So they're pretty heavy, a ton of kilograms. So they're pretty heavy, as you can imagine. And they're also very noisy too. But they have these really long front flippers. So they're able to get out of the water and onto land, unlike the seals. But who do you think might be trying to eat the seals and the sea lions?
Polar bears.
Polar bears, okay. Who else? What other guesses?
Killer whales?
Killer whales? Yeah, so we don't actually have polar bears here. They're going to be further up north in Alaska, but we definitely have the killer whales around. Usually see orcas around this time of year, but I just filmed this about a month ago, so sometimes they are in this area, but for the most part whales are going to be here in the summertime. But these are our orcas, or our killer whales, and they're also known as toothy whales. And I have a replica tooth to show you what it looks like. So this is the orca tooth, but really you'd only see about this far down because the rest would be up in the gums. But they're also called the wolves of the sea. So those are those apex predators that would be going after the seals or sea lions. But one way you can tell the difference between a male and a female by looking at them is if you check out their dorsal fins right here. So the females, they're gonna have this curved dorsal fin, whereas the males, they have more of this straight angular dorsal fin. And then this white spot right here is usually called the eye spot, but really their eye is gonna be right in front of there. So this is another kind of whale we have. Does anyone want to guess what type this is? This is a little bit of a close-up, and this is its top jaw right here. Don't be shy, it's okay.
Isn't it a humpback?
Yeah, you're right. It is a humpback whale. See? Good job. And so humpback whales, they don't have any teeth. They have this other structure right here. Does anyone know what this is called? So this is going to be called baleen. So this is its top jaw right here. And I have a piece of baleen to show you guys what it looks like. And so usually when it's in the whale's mouth, it's going to be straight. But when it comes out, it curves. So that's why it kind of has this warp shape to it. But if you want to know what it feels like, tap the top of your nails. So our nails are made out of the same material as this baleen is. And the edges right here, you can kind of tell, comes apart a little bit. So this is like the edge of a broom would be, or like pine needles. So kind of similar to that. But how it works is that the whale is going to go down, it's going to open its mouth and start taking on a lot of fish and a lot of water. But it doesn't want to swallow 50,000 liters, you know, that's a lot of water, right? So it's going to use its tongue and it's going to start pushing out all of that water. And all the fish is going to get trapped in the baleen. So once the water's out, then the whale will use its tongue and it'll swallow all of that fish. So every time it goes down, it's going to get about 80 kilograms of fish. So quite a lot of fish, but these are really big animals. So they spend most of their day feeding. They have to eat about 2000 kilograms a day. And so they also have another way of feeding, and this is called bubble net feeding. So they'll see a school of fish and they'll start swimming around it in a circle, blowing bubbles. And so that bubble net, it's going to start out pretty big, but as the fish get kind of disoriented and start swimming to the surface of the water, it's going to get smaller and smaller and smaller. And then once the fish are close to the surface and the net has gotten quite small, the whale is going to open its mouth and swim upwards and just scoop all that fish up. So that's kind of what it looks like from the top when the whales have just come up to the surface. And so we also have a lot of islands here, and this is an image of South Marble Island. What kind of wildlife do you think you would see around the islands? So we have a lot of birds around the islands, including this guy. Does anyone know what kind of animal this is?
This is a species of puffin.
Yeah, this is the puffin. Yeah, great job. Sometimes people think that this is a toucan. So now I like to call them toucans of the sea, but this is the puffin. And they spend a lot of time out at sea fishing, but they'll also come to the islands to nest. And yeah, and this is another bird that we see near the islands. And this is called the common murre. And you might notice that the top of their bodies is black and the bottom is white. And that's a technique known as countershading camouflage. So if an eagle was flying overhead looking down, it wouldn't be able to see the top of this bird because it's going to blend in with the color of the water or the rocks on the island. Whereas their fish that's swimming underneath them that they're trying to eat, if they look up, they're going to see the sun and the sky. So it's going to be really light. And so they won't know that the bird is above them. So it's a good way for them to be camouflaged from the top and the bottom. And so they'll come to the islands and they'll nest on these rocky cliff sides. And they look a little bit like penguins. So they're the closest things to penguins that we have here in the park. Does anyone know why their egg might look like this? Any guesses?
To prevent it from rolling?
Yeah, to prevent it from rolling. Yeah, great job. So if it was a circle, it would just go straight off the cliffside. But this way, it's actually going to spin in a circle. So it'll stay on the hill and it won't go off. And then their color, it's also kind of camouflaged so it blends in with that rocky surface. So great job. And this is another kind of bird that we usually see around the islands. And this is called our marbled murrelet. And so this top image here, that's what the females look like. And then these are the males down here. So they have those different colorations to them. Which leads me to a question for you guys. So marbled murrelets fly blink miles or kilometers, again, in the parentheses, to feed their young. What do you think? 1.6, 8, 16, 40, or 80? I see fours and fives, lots of fours. I see 1, 5, lots of fours, some threes. Yeah, so I'm gonna show you a little map. So this is the Marble Islands here in Glacier Bay. And this is Juneau way over here. And so these marbled murrelets nest just off of Juneau. So every single time they fly into Glacier Bay to go fishing around the Marble Islands, they're actually flying 80 kilometers or 50 miles. So those are some really dedicated parents right there. Yeah. And this is another animal we frequently see here at the park. I actually just filmed this last Thursday, so there are so many different animals. Does anyone know what this is before I just spoil it? You can shout it out if you know what animal that is.
An otter?
Yeah, this is an otter, and this is the sea otter. We do also have river otters here. Usually they're kind of swimming more forward, and they don't have this light-colored face like the sea otters have. But you can tell this sea otter is actually a female because if you look closely, her nose is this light color. That's actually because it's been sort of disturbed. So the males will actually bite the females' noses during mating season. So that's why it looks like that. But these sea otters, we have about 8,000 of them here in the park. And they really like to eat fish. So they'll try catching fish, but a lot of times they're just going to dive down to the bottom of the seafloor. And they'll come up with a little shell, lay on their back like this guy's doing right here. And then they actually have a little pocket underneath their armpits. And that's where they'll keep their favorite rock. So they'll lie on their back, take out their favorite rock, and use that to beat the shell against until it opens up. And when it does, they're going to slurp out the contents, do a little spin, and that shell is going to fall back down to the ocean floor. And then their dinner table is basically cleared, so they're ready to dive back down for their next meal. But they're also the only marine mammal without any blubber. And blubber is that layer of fat beneath the skin. So I have a question for you guys. So for every inch or 2.5 centimeters of fur, how many hairs do you think a sea otter has? 50, 500, 1,000, 10,000, or more than a million? And I see fours and I see fives so far. I see some more fives. I see lots of fours and lots of fives, okay. Yeah, so you guys know they have a lot of hairs. They're actually going to have more than a million per inch or 2.5 centimeters. And this is what their fur looks like. And so you can tell my finger just completely disappears when I touch it. And that's because it is so thick. And just to put it into perspective, our water here is pretty cold. It's usually around 34 degrees, so about 1 degree Celsius to 4 degrees Celsius, so it can get up to about 38 degrees Fahrenheit in the summer, so pretty cold water year round, so they need to have really thick fur. And one of my favorite activities while I've been here is to go tide pooling. And so as the sun sets, so does the tides. That's because in the winter time, we have all of our low tides at night. And actually this week is the first time the tides are starting to be low again in the mornings. But every 2 weeks when the sun, the earth, and the moon are aligned, that's when we have the greatest differences in the low and the high tides. So whenever there's a new moon or a full moon, if you're near the water, go check out those low tides because you see all sorts of cool things. So does anyone want to take a guess at what this might be? And this is kind of what it looks like from underneath, although this is a separate one.
Starfish?
Starfish, okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anything
else? He also says a kraken.
Octopus?
A Kraken. I like that guess.
Fossil sun?
Oh, which one? Say it again.
Fossil sun. No, I was just kidding.
Fossil sun. No, no, that is close though, because you said sun, and this is actually called a sunflower sea star. So a lot of people think the name is starfish, but it's actually a sea star. And this is the sunflower one. So if you look closely, you might notice the middle kind of resembles that center of a sunflower, and then the legs coming off are kind of like petals. So yeah, this is the sunflower sea star, and it's a predatory sea star. So we only see it if it's a low tide or if you go scuba diving, but normally it's going to be moving around underwater, and it's going to be trying to eat these little guys, which are other smaller sea stars. It also might be trying to eat limpets, which are little aquatic snails like this guy here. And they might be even trying to eat these guys, but probably not. This is called the nudibranch. This is my favorite, one of my favorite animals. And these nudibranchs are actually called sea slugs, but they come in all different colors. And last night I saw a really cool one that I will show you guys all after, because I just love them so much. But they come in all different colors, so. And then we also have some strange looking things that you find on the beach sometimes, like this. And this is going to be our scale worm. So they're one of many marine worm species we have, but I've never seen them eating before. So it's kind of creepy, but also kind of cool to see them eating. So on the beach, sometimes we also see different footprints. So who do you think that might have left these? Is this a bear, a porcupine, a wolf, or a moose? Threes. And I'm also seeing ones. So ones and threes. Yeah. Does anyone have any dogs?
Not now, but that's what I thought. It was a wolf.
Exactly. So they look a little bit like dog prints, but a lot of people also guess bears, but you guys did really good, mostly guessing wolves. So we do have lots of wolves here. And this is kind of what they look like. Some of them are dark brown and black, others are more grayish, and then we also just have some blackish gray ones. So, and in the evening, sometimes you'll hear them howling. All right, so who might have left these prints? Is this the bear, the porcupine, the wolf, or the moose? Yeah, this is gonna be our bear, right? Does anyone know what kind of bear this is?
Grizzly? No.
A grizzly? Yeah. That's going to be our grizzly or our brown bear. And here we usually just call them brown bears, but they are grizzlies. And they're pretty big, so they spend a lot of time out on the beachy open areas. And they'll be trying to lift up some of these mussel-covered rocks, looking for crabs or little animals beneath them. And they have these really long, dull claws, and these are used primarily for digging. But one way you can tell the difference between them and other bear species is that they have this really noticeable shoulder hump on them. They also have more of a round, dish-shaped face and a curved snout and these rounded ears. So those are the brown bears. Has anyone seen this kind of bear before? Thumbs up if you've seen it. Thumbs down if you have. Oh, and if you have a guess, yeah, go ahead. Tell me what you think it might be.
Looks like a... There's a species of black bear or brown bear in Alaska. Is this a black bear?
Yeah, this is a black bear. This is in particular called the glacier bear. And it is a black bear, so you're absolutely right. And these glacier bears, they usually are kind of can be a grayish blue color or just a grayish color, but they're particular only to this small area of southeastern Alaska, so they're very rare. But yes, they are the black bear, and you can tell here's the mama black bear, and she's got two glacier bear cubs, so they just have that different coloration to them. So great job. And black bears, they can be all sorts of colors. They can be blonde, they can be brown, they can be cinnamon, but they don't have that shoulder hump like the brown bears have. They're gonna have more of a straight snout that goes out, and then they're gonna have these long pointed ears. And they have these really sharp curved claws, and these are good for climbing. So they tend to spend a lot more time in these woody, foresty areas. All right. You guys probably all know what this animal is. You want to shout it out?
Is it an elk? I said the Norwegian word.
Oh, yeah. You are right, though. Yeah, this is going to be our moose. And so, does anyone know what the moose's main defense mechanism is?
Screaming?
Screaming? So sometimes people think it's their antlers, but you can tell this guy doesn't have any antlers. And so the female moose never have antlers. And then in the winter, the male moose lose their antlers. So their main defense are actually going to be their long legs. So they have a very powerful kick that they can use against wolves or bears. But having long legs also really helps walking around in the snow that we have in the winter. And so in the winter time, they're going to be roaming around, eating lots of sticks and twigs. And in the spring, that's when the babies are born, and they'll be eating all that fresh vegetation. All right, so what kind of adaptations do you think porcupines have to protect them? And do you guys all know what porcupines are? Thumbs up if you do. Thumbs down if you're not sure. If you're not sure, like a sideways thumb. Most people do. All right, so there's two answers for this, so you can use both of your hands. So one finger if you think they swim, two if they climb, three for jump, four for charge, and five for quills. I see fives, and I see fives and threes I'm seeing so far, and twos maybe. Fives, twos, ones, all kind of numbers. Okay, here's a hint for you guys. So number two is correct. They climb trees, and they also have quills. So they're very spiky. And we also have baby porcupines, and these are called porcupets. Can you guys all say porcupet?
Porcupet.
Porcupet. So even though they look really cute and cuddly, and their name says to pet them, we don't want to do that because they also have those sharp quills. All right. So behind me, I got a few other animals. I'm just going to point at each of them, and I want you to give me a thumbs up if you think that they live here. Thumbs down if we don't have them in the park. So do you think we have porpoises here? Some people say yes, some people say no. Maybe. What about caribou? Okay, I'm seeing some thumbs up. Mountain goats? Okay, and it's okay if you're not sure. What about bighorn sheep? Some people are indecisive, maybe. Bald eagles? Yeah, okay. Polar bears? This should be the easy one. Remember, we learned what kind of bears we have? Yeah, good job. So caribou are going to be further up north. So here in the park, we have porpoises, lots of bald eagles, and we also have mountain goats. And mountain goats are one of my favorite animals. As you can tell, they have no fear of heights. This guy's just jumping off a cliffside here. So what kind of adaptations do you think they have that allow them to live in the mountains?
No fear of heights?
Yeah, no fear of heights, yes. Definitely.
Something with their hoof. They have some sort of hoof that lets them cling onto the mountain, though, don't they? It's quite nimble.
Their hoof, yeah. the hoof pads were like incredibly detailed. It was something like almost like sandpaper with a, I don't know how
rough. Yeah, they kind of hook onto the mountain.
Yeah, okay, their hooves. What else? What is there anything about their color or their fur maybe? Yeah?
Oh, yeah, I guess in Alaska it needs to be white.
Yeah, white to blend in with the snow. So you guys were right, their hooves that help them stay on a very narrow cliff sides, and then they have really powerful legs. They're white to blend in with the snow, and they also have this really, really thick fur, so they can survive in up to negative 45 degrees Celsius or negative 50 Fahrenheit, so really cold temperatures. Which kind of brings us into climate change in Glacier Bay. So things are starting to change here. We're following the same trend as most of Alaska, and that's that 95% of glaciers are either stagnating, so they're staying the same, they're receding, so they're starting to disappear, or they're thinning. And so we have that same trend here, although we do actually have two glaciers, and that's the John Hopkins and the Gilman glaciers that are actually advancing and growing. So that's a good thing. But we don't know exactly what climate change is necessarily going to look like in the future. We are kind of in a rainforest, so we're expecting a lot more precipitation, but it kind of depends what happens in the mountains. So we have the Fairweather mountain range here, and that's one of the highest coastal mountain ranges in the world. And so our highest peak is over 4,000 meters, so it's pretty big. And if that precipitation comes as rain, it's going to help accelerate the melt of the glaciers. But if it comes as snow, it could actually help them stay the same or potentially even grow. But just to kind of put it in perspective, some of the changes that have been happening, this is what Carroll Glacier looked like way back in 1906. So you can see we have all the ice right here, and down below we have all this water from the sea. And then almost 100 years later in 2004, this is another picture. And you really can't see the ice. It's way behind the corner over here. And even the water's gone. So we're seeing those plants coming in from the primary plant succession. And then again with Muir Glacier, just over 100 years, we see this was the glacier up here, and we have lots of icebergs in the water. And then after 115 years, there's no snow or no ice anywhere. And some of this change is natural. It's normal for glaciers to kind of advance and recede, but we're just starting to see more of them receding a lot more rapidly now. So since the 1950s, Glacier Bay's ice has shrunk by blank percent. What do you think? 5%, 15, 35, 50, or 80%? I've seen fives and threes and fours and fives, yeah. So fortunately, it is only gone back by 15%. We actually only have 27% ice here. So we're also a lot of water and a lot of forest. So we are losing ice, but not 80% yet, thank goodness. Hopefully never. But yeah.
But you're not animal... using in your glacier, but in other glaciers in the world, there is up to 80%. Okay, yeah.
And we are still losing a lot. It's just that, like, in total, we haven't lost that much yet. But definitely in other parts of Alaska, they're losing even more. So yeah, for sure. But one species that is impacted by that is the ice worm. So if you remember from the beginning of our presentation with the marshmallows, we have all those little air pockets in the ice. And so that's where these ice worms like to live. They like to crawl around between these air pockets looking for pollen or other plant material that has either been blown in or been carried down by the glaciers. And so ice is also a really good insulator. So it's usually just around 0 degrees Celsius or about 32 Fahrenheit. And so they love that temperature. If it gets too warm, so if we're reaching about 4 or 5 degrees Celsius, they're actually going to start melting and they'll die. So we're seeing fewer and fewer of these ice worms on the glaciers. And just to put it into perspective, they're about a centimeter tall, so not very big. And they're roughly the width of one human hair, so they're really small. But those are another species that's getting to be impacted by climate change. And so I just have a few more pictures I wanted to show you guys. And these are all photos that I've taken since I've been here. And so this is Marjorie Glacier, and this is probably the most popular glacier that people come to see. And 90% of our visitors are coming by cruise ships, so most never even leave the boat at all. And then these are some sea lions that you'll pass if you go up bay here. And then we have some mountain goats that are just hanging out here. So in the winter time, when it's a lot colder, there'll be at lower elevations. And then in the summertime, when it's warmer, they're going to be going up higher into the mountains. But they're also having more of a difficult time of climate change as it gets to be too hot for them. And then this is just kind of our public dock down here at Bartley Cove. So this is just something I walk to usually every day. And then this is our view from right outside the tribal house. And this is kind of looking over at Bartley Cove. And just another view, these are the Fairweather Mountains behind me. And this is our view from just right outside of headquarters here. We have this little inner lagoon, and it's been kind of cold this winter, so we've actually had some times where it's frozen over, and there have actually been seals out on the ice. That has been cool. And then just the sunsets down at Bartley Cove are pretty nice. But I got a little video to show you guys about my experiences here, and it's just very short, and so don't blink because you might miss something. Towards the end of my presentation, this is actually an internship that I've been doing. I left my real National Park Service job to come here, and that was the best decision ever. So if anyone is ever interested in coming to the U.S. and doing an internship, I recommend Student Conservation Association. It's a great way to get out and travel and see different places and be outdoors. So it's really cool. Yeah, I see one person who might be interested, and they have opportunities all across the U.S., so you never know what you'll be doing.
Oh, we gotta get his visa approved first.
Well, yeah, when you get that, like, then that definitely look into it. But there's also a lot of other opportunities. So if you like art, we got artists in residence programs with the national parks. Pathways, that's if you were to be, if you want to do another degree and you want to work for the government, great thing. We have lots of different internships. There's also citizen science programs and just different ways to volunteer. So that kind of brings me to the end of our tour, except for I have one more activity before I answer any questions from you guys. And so for some of you might know that all the national parks in the U.S. have this program called Junior Rangers. I forgot I have this slide. Thank you for coming. you guys are going to become Junior Rangers, but first you have to have a little glacier joke. So the thing about the rivers is that they make these V-shaped valleys as they go through, but glaciers, you know, we have a lot of material that we're packing, so it's kind of more like a punch. So we punch through and we make these U-shaped valleys. So thank you guys for coming. But now it's your turn to become some junior rangers for Glacier Bay. So if you will all raise your right arm and repeat after me. All right. I promise to protect and preserve. All the plants and animals.
The places and animals.
At Glacier Bay National Park.
At Glacier Bay National Park.
And I promise to teach my friends and family.
And I promise to teach my friends and family.
All I've learned here today.
All I've learned here today.
All right, congratulations, you guys. You're all officially junior rangers. And if you really want, you can give me your address sometime before Friday, and I can actually send you these little junior ranger stickers. But congratulations. Does anyone have any questions for me? Or if you guys want to learn about other things, I know it's really late there, but if you want to stay up late learning about cold water coral or whales or something, I have nothing going on today, so I'll be around. But yeah, if you guys have any questions, feel free to let me know.